Woe to you, O earth and sea. For the devil sends the beast with wrath, because he knows the time is short. Let him who hath understanding reckon the number of the beast, for it is a human. Its number is 666.
Hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666.
No matter who you meet, if you say 666, all of a sudden they know what you're talking about.
2,000 years ago, John the Apostle received a revelation from God, predicting the arrival of the false prophet and the man of sin.
Stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns.
The most powerful nation on earth is set to betray its citizens. With new mandatory revisions to citizenship and constitutional privacy.
The United Kingdom's Information Commissioner claims that in 2017, consumers will be cashless shoppers. A microchip holding personal bank account and credit card information will be implanted into the body, connecting to a database that will know who they are, where they live, what they like, and what they don't like. Shoppers will have their hand scanned, not their credit card.
And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name.
We want to investigate how close we actually are to implementing the mark of the beast. We're going to find out that we are closer than most people think. Now, the prophecy foretells a time when each of us will have a mark or a number without which we will not be permitted to buy or sell. It paints a picture of a system of total control.
A system touted as a national security necessity is being used to build a database where the biometric identity of millions of Americans will be gathered and stored.
We're meeting with the president in order to formulate legislation that would require every person in the United States of America who is employed to carry a biometric identification card with them.
And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. And that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name.
The president put in a lot of money in the stimulus package to advance medical records so that if you have the chip, you can carry the records with you. They can stick it in a computer. They can know all your situations.
They'll have a GPS chip in there so that they can measure everybody, every instant, no matter where they go.
Your ID card would have either your fingerprint, your thumbprint on there, or it would have a reading of the veins in the back of your hand.
If any man worship the beast and his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb.
Researchers are developing sheets of ultra-thin, ultra-flexible electronics that can stick to your body. These electronic skins, or e-skins, can bend when you flex your elbow and twist when you rotate your wrist. Researchers are just beginning to imagine all the medical innovations that could come from these e-skins. University of Tokyo professor Takao Somea has been developing electronics that are flexible, bendable, and stretchable for 10 years. Somea's goal is to create electronics that are as pliable as human skin. and he's come a long way in a decade. This is Somaya's latest prototype, an electronic sheet that is 10 times thinner than plastic kitchen wrap. It is light enough to float through the air like a feather. The first challenge in manufacturing e-skins is to find a way to produce flexible electronics. Somaya fabricates his circuits using thin film transistors, which can be printed on plastic films. These films are well suited for synthetic skins because the material is cheap and easy to handle. Somaya's material can be stretched, folded, or crumpled up like paper, but the electronics on it still work. That's why it might be useful for biomedical applications. This lightweight material can cling to human skin, and it can bend and stretch as people move their bodies. E-skin could be used for health monitoring systems and wearable medical instruments. By adding sensors to the circuits, researchers can measure the electrical activity of an athlete's muscles or a hospital patient's vital signs. One day, it might even become synthetic skin for robots or humans.
Anyone who takes the mark is immediately thrown in the lake of fire. There's no grace, there's no mercy. It's just, you've got the mark, bam, you're in the lake of fire.
If you pledge allegiance to the Antichrist, you will be eternally damned, according to the Bible.
How would you like to have an RFID microchip implanted underneath your skin? Or maybe an electronic tattoo that sticks to your arm or your wrist? Not only does it look badass and trendy, but it's also every bit as useful and complex as your smartphone. I know it sounds like something futuristic or even something out of a science fiction movie, but guess what? The future is now. Not only does this technology already exist, but it's already being developed and implemented at a rapid and accelerated pace as the technological elite finally begin to bridge the gap between our digital and physical identities.
It sounds like science fiction, placing a microchip under the skin to get you in your door, to start your car, or maybe give your doctor your medical history.
Or what if your child were to disappear? Would you be willing to place a chip in your child if it might help them bring them home? Barry Davis recently looked into what all this technology is about and the possibilities of this science.
According to the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, more than 2,000 children are reported missing each day. Most are found, some never are. But what if there was the technology which could help bring those children home? And that technology was no bigger than a grain of rice.
Elliot! Oh gosh. He's on the swings. Oh hi. Yeah, that scared me.
It's something most every parent has felt, that sick panic. You're watching your child play, having fun. You turn your head for just a moment, and they're gone.
My stomach drops, I feel nauseous and dizzy, and I imagine all of the horrible things that could happen.
Tris Dickerson is the mother of a rambunctious 3.5-year-old who has no fear of anything or anybody.
And it scares me. It scares me so much. Someone would just be like, hey, I have candy, and he'd be like, heck yes, candy.
We've been microchipping our pets for years, so why not use that technology to protect something far more precious?
It's technically realistic.
Stuart Lipoff is an electronics engineer who's watching the microchip industry closely. He says by placing signposts or portals like this handheld unit for animals in key locations, you could track someone. Some people are already placing microchips in their hands, which help them control everything from their computers to opening their front doors. And most of us use microchips every day to open doors to work or buy lunch with a debit or credit card.
The ick factor, it still is kind of icky of, having somebody, put something into your body that's a foreign thing.
Lipoff says it's only a matter of time before people realize how beneficial it could be. And not just for convenience, but in what literally could be a life-saving instance.
I might be one of those moms. In a heartbeat, I think I'd have him chipped. Just so I would feel safer.
There are devices you can buy to put on your kids, which allows you to track them with GPS. Right now, the technology to track a microchip with GPS isn't available. At least, not available to the public.
But here's what you should really worry about. And watch. It will unfold like this. First, the RFID chip. Radio frequency identification. It's already been put in the Blink credit cards, passports, license tags. They're everywhere. Watch for a full court press to have them implanted in your pets. Not an ID chip, a tracker. They're beta tested, but you'll start to see more of them at your vet's offices. OnStar for your pooch. You can track your little doggy. Peace of mind. Next, if it's good enough for your dog, it's good enough for your child. A tiny little RFID chip the size of a grain of rice. Completely safe. Easy to remove. Your child is now kidnap proof. And the placement of the chip will be varied, so God forbid some sicko doesn't look at one particular place to forcibly remove it. OnStar for your child. No more Amber Alerts, no more kidnapping, no more parents' worst nightmare. After all, if it's good enough for your pet, it's good enough for your child, then the elderly. Forget that I've fallen and can't get up business. Oh, no, no, this RFID chip will have all of Grandma's medical information and data on it. And if they have dementia, wander off, you'll be able to track them. After all, if it's good enough for your dog. Then once it's deemed cool, teens will insist on their own chip. They're already tattooing barcodes. It's cool. It's their own number. And this will be your own chip. All of your information, always stressing the medical information bit. What information? She's 20 years old. Shh. It's for her own good. And you can track them. And you know that kids won't wear watches anymore. They've got cell phones with the time on it. In your cool chip, no need for driver's licenses, credit cards, debit cards, keyless entry, ID, no. The RFID chip will have it all there, all of it. Goodbye wallets. After all, what's a wallet for? ID, cards, not anymore. Oh, and money will be completely cashless. Blink terminals will read your chip. Think Easy Pass or MetroCard, no cash, no drug trafficking, no terrorism. Make any connection you want. No one's listening anyway. Then you'll beg for one. Everything's on the chip. Everyone's on the grid. The grid is a 24/7 real-time tracking of you. Everyone will have this cool chip. Everyone's on the grid. And if you're convicted of breaking some law, they don't send you to prison. They turn off your chip. Poof. You don't exist. No money, no identity, no existence. And you're worried about an iPhone being tracked? You ain't seen nothing yet.
To think, something so small could control you.
And everything you do.
When your life and all you love
are on the line.
The RFID chip is always with you, threatening your privacy, causing severe risk to your health and personal safety, and killing you if you do not obey rogue government demands.
Because I want to increase my risk of cancer.
Because I want to live in a cash-free society.
Because now, the government is looking out for us.
Because I have the mark of the beast, but it doesn't have me.
Ask your doctor how to get your chip implanted today.
Side effects may include, but are not limited to, depression, drowsiness, itchy throat, high blood pressure, low blood sugar, heartburn, bad breath, athlete's foot, acid reflux, gingivitis, upset stomach, blurred vision, cottonmouth, sore throat, sore gums. Even more side effects include spontaneous combustion, Down syndrome, bankruptcy, back problems, gout, temporary blindness, heart failure, dyslexia, total shutdown of vital organs. Other side effects include paralysis, neurocorrosion, seizures, AIDS, lung drowning, kidney failure, testicle erosion, change in skin pigmentation, dwarfism, moderate to severe Crohn's disease, cardiac arrest, detached retina, loss of teeth, peeling skin, death. It's time you took control of your life. Don't turn down another invitation.
Because we want to track your every move.
Are you serious? We're living in the days of the mark of the beast. The end of the age. We're on the brink of the beast. We're on the edge of eternity. We're at the apocalyptic hour. Something biblical is going on with the signs of the second coming of Christ and the seven-headed monster. The beast is about to rise from a sea of humanity, unaware of its dark desperate domain of Satan, the devil himself, who's clinging to the very hope that he can overthrow the saints of God, but he can never get it done because greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. But there's a new chip coming. There's a new chip coming, and we should have known. We absolutely should have known what was coming.
That means you're not going to be able to fly an airplane. You're not going to be able to enter a federal building. You won't be able to drive a car. You won't be able to open a bank account. And you are not going to be able to hold a job. Now, this is where the rubber meets the road. The U.S. Food and Drug Administration approved the injection of this chip under the skin. The technology is in place. It is happening right now. It's very important that all of us understand the mark of the beast is not a possibility. It is an absolute certainty. You and I are going to face it. Make sure your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life.
And he provides that no one will be able to buy or to sell except the one that has the mark, either the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for the number is that of a man, and his number is 666.
Can a microscopic tag be implanted in a person's body to track his every movement? There's actual discussion about that. You will rule on that, mark my words, before your tenure is over. Can brain scans be used to determine whether a person is inclined toward criminality or violent behavior? You will rule on that.
The end purpose of numbering a population is always to control them. And do I need to remind you that control and freedom are opposite terms? If Fido's on a leash, he's under control. But if the leash breaks and he runs through the neighborhood, now he's free. So what do we want to do? Do we want to be on the leash of big government, or do we want to be free? You cannot have freedom when the population is numbered.
So how close are we to actually having microchips implanted under our skin? Well, according to the NBC Nightly News with Brian Williams, we might be a lot closer than you think.
More now of our special coverage here tonight, life in the U.S. in 10 years' time. By that time, there may be all kinds of new ways to safeguard and identify all those things that make each of us unique, our faces, even our fingerprints, even our eyes.
Science fiction 20 years ago, but a biometric reality today.
The technology is based on answering one simple question. Am I who I say I am?
Already, fingerprints and iris scans verify passenger identities at airports. Within 10 years, that technology may be even more widespread. And look for more complex facial recognition programs that scan a crowd of thousands looking for a single terrorist.
Today's facial recognition software starts with the eyes, then it maps out the contours of the face and compares that against a database of millions, a database that's growing by the day.
What's next? At the University of Bath in England, researchers predict big changes for consumers.
I think it is possible to free us completely of our wallets and keys using biometric technology, if that's what people want in 10 years' time.
In fact, it's already here. The latest home security locks use fingerprints to control deadbolts. And at the Jewel Osco grocery store in Chicago, some customers pay using their fingerprints. No paper or plastic.
You don't really need anything other than your hand, and you already got that with you.
So will future department stores scan our irises, like in the movie Minority Report, then offer products catered to who we are?
Hello, Mr. Yakamoto. Welcome back to the Gap.
Experts say that technology is here now. The challenge is to safeguard our privacy in a brave new world.
There you go.
From MRIs to EKGs, sonograms to scanners, medical technology allows doctors to monitor vital information about the inner workings of the human body. Imagine if some of these machines could be made so thin, light, and portable that they could be attached right to the surface of your skin and go wherever you go.
There's some very sophisticated device functionality sitting on my skin now.
Two NSF-funded innovators have done just that by engineering something called an electronic tattoo, a microelectronic health monitor that has the potential to revolutionize the field of healthcare technology.
The electronic has always been rigid. To make electronics flexible, I mean, that's quite a challenge.
The path taken by John Rogers and Hyun-Gong Hwang to develop the electronic tattoo is an example of how collaboration is often a key or critical part of the innovation process. It all started in 2005 when both men worked at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, and Hwang happened to stop by a lecture Rogers was giving on campus.
Then we started talking and we find John's work very fascinating, and John find my work on mechanics useful. So naturally the two of us evolve and work together.
At the time of their first encounter, Rogers, a material scientist and electrical engineer, was looking for new ways to use electronic circuits formed on the surface of silicon. Silicon is a natural semiconductor that has electrical properties between that of a conductor, a material in which an electrical charge can flow freely, and an insulator, a material that doesn't conduct an electrical charge at all. Semiconductors are the heart of most electronics today.
So at a very simple level, you can use a semiconductor like silicon as a switching element to turn electricity off or on.
Hwang, a mechanical engineer who has since moved to Northwestern University, specializes in the mechanics of curvilinear materials, which have surfaces that are wavy.
Curvilinear surface means it's a surface that's not flat. That's not, for example, my hat. The surface is curvilinear.
By combining their fields of expertise to hatch the initial idea of the tattoo, they set out to manufacture a prototype, something that has taken about 7 years and multiple breakthroughs to produce.
Well, one of the key things is to make electronics as flexible as possible that can follow the scheme morphology.
The first breakthrough happened when they figured out how to slice off the surface layer of a silicon wafer. This new technique resulted in silicon that could bend, just like this single sheet of paper. Next, they discovered how to make silicon elastic, allowing it to be either flat or wavy in shape.
Suddenly, you have a form of silicon that can bend, it can stretch, it can deform, it can coat and conform to curvilinear shapes, very much like biological tissues.
Even though it is called a tattoo, there is no need to pierce or puncture the skin. Instead, the device sticks on.
So what we can do then is we can take this device, laminate it on the skin, almost like a children's temporary transfer tattoo.
To figure out how to engineer this, Rogers and Hwang look to nature, noting how easily lizards stick to walls.
Like gecko and others, they can easily attach to a wall and easily let go. So for us, we want to borrow some of that idea and to make the electron not using glue to have strong adhesion with the skin.
Once attached, it can wirelessly detect electrical signals from inside the body, such as those given off by cells within the heart that cause it to contract and pump blood through its four chambers.
This particular device is powered inductively. So there's a coil here. I can bring a wireless power supply in proximity to this device and deliver power to it through the air.
Rogers and Hwang filed at least 10 different patent applications with the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office to protect their invention before commercializing it. Patents allow inventors to acquire what are known as intellectual property rights to their inventions for limited periods of time.
The intellectual property is absolutely crucial. If that's not done carefully and thoughtfully, and if you don't really have distinctively new ideas that are well separated from things that people have tried in the past, it won't be viable. You won't be able to commercialize it.
A startup company called MC10 has licensed the multiple patents and patent applications and is developing a new generation of flexible healthcare devices.
While doing mechanics work, I never thought that I would have so much interaction with electrical engineers or material scientists. But now it's really at the interface we create new devices that never existed before.
Innovation brought to life by a unique and long-lasting collaboration that has the potential to stretch the limits of modern healthcare technology.
Whether it's for getting on a bus or getting into the office, many of us these days are used to swiping an electronic card. But how would you feel if the microchip wasn't in the card, but in your hand instead?
Not holding in your hand. Under the skin. Well, one company in Sweden is doing just that. It offers its staff the chance to have the chip inserted. Our technology correspondent, Rory Kathleen Jones, has been finding out how it works.
Stockholm and a nondescript building has been converted into a high-tech office space. But look under the skin to find something really futuristic. Felicio da Costa doesn't need a pass to get in. Then it's another swipe of his hand for access to his office. What's going on?
I've got a chip implant. So that's why the doors let me in.
Where's the chip?
The chip is right inside here.
The new offices will soon host a shifting population of 700 entrepreneurs and employees, and they'll all be offered the chance to get chipped if they wish. As well as opening doors, that'll allow them to use the photocopiers and eventually to log on to computers or pay for food in the cafe.
Hi, Hennes. Can I get your contacts?
The man behind the scheme, whose business card can be accessed via his chip, says the aim is to learn lessons.
We want to be able to understand this technology before big corporates and big government come to us and say, hey, everyone should get chipped, the tax authority chip, or the Google chip, or Facebook chip.
Another feature of this unconventional office, dogs are welcome. But while we're used to having our pets chipped, putting technology under our own skin may be a step too far.
Let's talk now to technology blogger Martin Bryant. And from our studio in Berkshire is Professor Kevin Warwick, who studies the relationship between technology and humans and is also believed to be the first person to have had a silicon chip surgically implanted into his body. Well, we've got to ask, Professor, where is this chip and how did it feel? Can you see it? Does it work?
Well, all of that. Hopefully I'm holding it up now. This is the one I actually had implanted, and it was implanted in my arm by a doctor. Part of it is a coil of wire, and that's how it gets its power, and that's how it communicates. And then the rest is a few chips on which you store an identifying code, and that code is transmitted out, which identifies you to the system.
And did it hurt when it was put in, and did you notice when it was in while you had it in?
I noticed it was there at first, but then very quickly you get used to it. The thing that Rory has got, I'm trying to hold up something, it's very difficult to see, but it's very, very small. It's like the size of a very small grain of rice, and that, I would guess, you wouldn't notice at all.
So, Martin, what do you make of it all?
Well, I don't think many people will be very keen to have a chip from their employer. I mean, it's like a pet being microchipped, isn't it? And I can see that maybe working in Sweden. I think they're a bit more chilled out and relaxed about such things. But in the UK, I can only see it really working maybe in really secure places, like where spies work or something, and you only want particular people in there. But your average office, no.
Well, Kevin, that's an interesting point, isn't it? Because I'm sure a lot of people would straight away think about that. It's like, what exactly is that chip doing? What's it checking? What's it know about what I do? That would be a kind of instinctive, natural reaction, wouldn't it?
Well, I think you get a different aspect on it, that if the company was to say, well, if you want to work here, you have to have a chip, that's part of the package, then it might be a different thing. And there's also other places like prisons or even for passport control where the chip could be very, very useful immediately.
Martin, I mean, your expertise is technology, and as technology develops, we get used to it, don't we? So most technology starts out as quite a bizarre idea, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, if you go back 300 years with a hearing aid on, people would think it was witchcraft or something, wouldn't they? So I think over time, our perceptions of technology change, and while you or I might feel a bit uncomfortable about this, things move over time, and so maybe our children or our children's children, maybe they'll be all cyborgs with enhanced hands and brains and all sorts, yeah.
We saw, Kevin, we saw in the film a moment ago the practicalities of how that works, people sort of having to hold their hands up against things, similar to the way we use our sort of laminated badges now. That doesn't feel like a huge stride forward in a way, because you're still having to go through those practicalities.
But I think when I held the small chip up, that's really where there's a problem. It's very, very small, and hence you have to try and get the antenna, the aerial that's in it, right up close so that you get a good connection. With the thing that I had, which is quite a bit bigger, so there wasn't a problem. It actually operated over 1 to 2 meters, so I was free to walk around, and the computer switched on lights for me, said hello, opened doors, and I didn't have to go up close to it. So it's really just, the technology's there, it's just using it in a different way.
And what kind of costs are we looking at, Martin? Is this technology practical in, you know, in economic terms, in budgetary terms, for companies to move forward with something like this?
Well, I think at the moment, because it's such a new technology, I think probably not. But certainly, it's something that over time will become more, as it becomes more commonplace, it'll become cheaper. I say as it becomes commonplace, I'm not sure you necessarily. It's down to employee acceptability, and then isn't it how much it's acceptable to them? And yes, I mean. It might be a great alternative to a passport, but will people really want their passport? Will they want technology in the body? I don't think so. It'll take a few generations maybe for that to really become a popular thing.
Kevin, what about you? Time frame on this one, what do you think?
Well, I disagree. I mean, if somebody said to me, and I'm sure you'd be the same, Charlie, you can have this very small chip implanted, and that means you can shortcut the passport queue that you get, go straight through, then you'd be on for it. If the deal is right, and I do believe for a lot of companies, the infrastructure is already in place, and smart cards usually trigger it off. This is just using a small chip. I don't really see the cost being a problem even now.
And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name.
I've said it before, I will say it again. We can't balance the budget on the backs of the very people who have borne the biggest brunt of this recession. Everyone's going to have to chip in. That's only fair. That's the principle I'll be fighting for during the next phase of this process.
Joining us now to make his case is Scott Silverman. He's chairman and CEO of Applied Digital Solutions. That's the parent company of Verichip. And Mr. Silverman, thanks for being here. We appreciate it. We're looking at this little chip right here. You brought some in with us, tiny little things. But what we heard yesterday was kind of scary. How do you react to that?
Well, Becky, thanks for having us back on the air. We appreciate that very much. And obviously the comments that were made yesterday is the reason that I'm sitting here today. As you know, Verichip has been approved by the FDA as a Class 2 medical device in order to identify high-risk patients in an emergency situation. It's elective, it's voluntary, and it is certainly critical to the evolution of information technology in healthcare, which we all know is archaic, the way healthcare is done today in emergency rooms and physicians' offices.
Do you hate it when you get to the office and then discover you left your ID at home? Well, one company in Sweden has come up with a unique way to make sure that doesn't happen. A microchip implant. NBC's Keir Simmons is in Stockholm this morning with more on that. Keir, good morning.
Hey guys, good morning. You've seen it in the movies. A human being merges with a computer to become a so-called cyborg. Well, I have now had a computer chip inserted into my left hand. It cost around $300. And in a moment, in what will surely be a live television first, I'm going to open a door with my cyborg hand.
We're going to put a man inside a machine.
Okay, so they're not going to turn me into RoboCop, but here in Sweden, at this high-tech office block, they're going to inject a computer chip into my hand.
And this is the guy who's going to do it.
Are you nervous?
I am nervous. Yeah. Yes.
You don't have to be. It's not going to be that bad.
Really? Because that's a big needle. Okay.
Cecilia Osterholm starts her day with this new technology. She swapped her keys for a chip in her hand that uses a radio signal to open doors.
You have a chip in your hand there?
That's right. It's been inserted there.
Right. So that's how do you open it? Just like that. So obviously what I really want to know is how much it hurts.
It does hurt a little bit, but it's like a basic vaccination shot, so it's not too bad.
Her office, Epicenter in Stockholm, connects big corporations like Microsoft with fast-growing companies. And for the first time in a workplace, all 700 employees here have been given the chance to use the technology to become more efficient.
So if you hold the phone against my chip, right, you will get my contact details.
Look, that's you.
In the movies, from Matrix to Minority Report, we've watched technology take over our lives.
It's a smart house.
It even happens in Annie.
Think it and it shall appear.
And now it's coming true in real life.
If you don't need keys to access your building, if you don't need credit cards or PIN codes and things like that to do purchases, those are things that will really simplify your life.
Life for me was about to get simpler. And you know what they say, no pain, no gain.
So the chip in here is quite small, right?
Yeah, it's super small. It's like a grain of rice.
So take a deep breath and exhale.
Ow!
And with that, I became part man, part machine. Right, cue the superhuman music, guys. Here comes the big reveal. Here on my left hand, you can still see the mark, is where that chip has been inserted into my hand. Now I am going to take this cyborg hand, I'm going to place it up against the reader here. There's a little blue reader that is looking at the chip in my hand.
Verichip, subsidiary of publicly traded Applied Digital, has added Tommy Thompson to its board of directors. Company hoping the former Health and Human Services Secretary can help accelerate the use of RFID for healthcare and security applications. Joining us to discuss the future of RFID and his plans for Verichip, Tommy Thompson, former Health and Human Services Secretary, and Scott Silverman, Chairman and CEO of Applied Digital. Gentlemen, thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you. It's an honor to be on your program.
Ms. Thompson, I'll start with you. We're doing a poll today. Would you have one of these things implanted in your arm, or I don't know, under your scalp, or wherever you put it?
You put it in your right arm, and it's very small, and it doesn't bother you at all. But it certainly is going to allow you to identify who you are, protect your child. If you have a new child that's born in a nursery, you can protect that child from having somebody walk off with it. You can also protect your loved ones in a nursing home so that you can put a bracelet on and identify that individual and be able to find that individual if that person wanders away. But I certainly would, and I think it's a coming thing. And the problem is that medical technology is so far behind that RFIDs are going to really be the impetus in order for us to get new technology in the medical field that's going to help people improve their quality of care. And that's what it's all about.
And I'm sorry, sir, did you just say you would get one implanted in your arm?
Absolutely, without a doubt.
Okay.
That's it.
No concerns? No concerns at all? Because I have to admit, it makes me a little queasy, makes me worry. What happens if it gets dislodged? Am I being irrational?
No, but just think of this. Now, if you were, wherever you are, if you're traveling, you're in New Jersey now and you're interviewing me in Washington, D.C.
Right.
Can you imagine if you were in Washington, D.C. and had an accident or had a stroke and went into the hospital? How long would it be before your records could get down here? How long would it take to be able to find out what sort of meds you're on or what allergies you have or what are you allergic to?
But people right now just use cards that are in their wallet. They carry around cards that say what my blood type is, if I have any allergies.
But the truth of the matter is, the doctor doesn't know that, and the emergency ward certainly wouldn't. And the problem is that technology is so far behind in the medical field that people are dying every day because of the lack of technology. There are 98,000 people died last year because of mistakes in hospitals and clinics across America. And a good share of those mistakes could have been prevented by technology. RFID is at the cutting edge of new technology is going to help to improve the quality of health and the quality of care for all Americans.
Mr. Silverman, what about privacy concerns?
Hi, Mark. Thanks for having us back again. I appreciate it. The privacy issue associated with RFID technology really disappears because Verichip is a voluntary product that is used by a patient for specific medical ailments, such as dementia, such as medical device recipients that need to identify their devices and their medical records, such as cardiac care patients and diabetic patients as well, who will voluntarily receive a Verichip, as they've started to receive them in the North Jersey area where Hackensack University Medical Center has adopted the system.
How many people have these embedded in them? I shouldn't say embedded, but put in them.
We've sold approximately 7,000 Verichips across the world right now. We believe that 2,000 of them approximately have been injected across the world, either for the medical or the security application. In the United States, we believe the number to be approximately 40 to 50 at this point, which all have occurred
40 to 50 people.
Correct. Which all have occurred since the FDA clearance of the product when you had us on back in October.
Yeah.
And then the rollout of the infrastructure in a number of hospitals in the Northeast region, which we look to expand the hospital infrastructure to 20 to 25 hospitals or emergency rooms by the end of 2005. And up to 200 emergency rooms by the end of 2006.
If I could turn to Secretary Thompson, just ask a quick question about your old job. Secretary Thompson, you were quoted last December as saying you have to assume that sometime in the future, one of our countries, meaning the larger developed countries, is going to be hit by a bioterrorism attack. I assume you saw an article in the Wall Street Journal yesterday detailing failures, at least thus far, in developing from with the U.S. government's help. New vaccines and drugs to counter biological threats, and I'm curious to get your reaction to that.
Well, I think the story is somewhat correct, but you got to realize that the United States was starting from nothing, and the Department of Health and Human Service passed the BioShield protective legislation in order for industry to start coming into the field to produce new vaccines and new countermeasures. It's in the embryonic stages, but I think you got to realize it's a giant step forward to where we were. We still got a long ways to go, and I still am very concerned about a bioterrorism attack.
Mr. Silverman, we're almost out of time, so I'd appreciate brief answers if you could, sir.
Sure.
Can you update the information on this chip? Because, of course, health conditions can change. You can develop diabetes, whatever.
Yes, absolutely. The chip itself, Mark, has only a 16-digit identification number, and the information for your medical record databases is kept on a database that you can update via the internet.
Okay. And does your company make the implantable chips for pets?
Yes, we do.
Okay.
We do it for pets, we do it for livestock with the National Identification Program, and we do it for people.
Because it just occurs to me, I mean, my kids are old enough to be able to be found, but it occurs to me I've got them in my dogs. Why wouldn't I have them in small children, too? Thank you very much, gentlemen. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
It's our honor. Thank you very much.
Tommy Thompson, former Health and Human Services Secretary. Scott Silverman, Chairman and CEO of Applied Digital. Don't forget to vote in our Squawk Back question. Would you implant or have implanted an RFID chip? They slide it under your skin of your arm. You don't even know it's there. Log on to squawkblog.com. Do you say, yes, I'd do it, or do you say, I'm with Becky, no way?
And with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast, and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone.
In medical news tonight, a chip the size of a grain of rice could save your life.
I've just been chipped myself. It's not a painless process, but it doesn't last too long, not too difficult, minor surgical procedure.
New microchip technology now makes it possible for the emergency room staff to find out about your medical history at the touch of a computer key.
At some point, we're all going to have RFIDs. It might be even in our fingers, where they require it with everything on it.
Instead of carrying credit cards or money, we will probably be implanted with chips.
And now RFID microchips like this are being injected into humans.
I'm sorry, sir, did you just say you would get one implanted in your arm?
Absolutely, without a doubt.
Our driver's license will be on the RFID chip. Our credit card number, all our information will be on this one chip.
The chip is encased in unbreakable glass and is about the size of a grain of rice. The procedure is done with anesthesia and is relatively pain-free.
It felt pretty scary, but at the same time it felt very modern, very 2015.
The government has just approved the use of a computer chip that would be implanted under your skin.
When complete, everyone will have a unique 12-digit identity number.
If hospitals purchase this detection equipment, the system will most likely start to include more and more people in those communities who will want the chips.
Wow.
Interesting.
Everybody
stuff.
Could have one of those one day.
Finally from us this evening, technology on the cutting edge. We were interested today to hear that more than 100 law enforcement officials in Mexico are having microchips implanted in their arms. The chips allow a person to be scanned, sort of like a cereal box at the supermarket checkout. In Mexico, This will be one more tool in the fight against crime. Here's ABC's John McKenzie.
You've seen it before, right out of Hollywood.
Maybe a little uncomfortable.
A microchip inside the body. A hidden high-tech identification tag.
They're the access codes to your job spot.
Now Mexico's attorney general and 160 of his deputies have had microchips implanted in their arms to control access to the country's new criminal investigation center.
And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed.
This is a developmental system made by MC10, and it has an antenna and some sensors embedded in it. And what we plan to do is work with them to advance a tattoo that could be used for authentication. It's really true. So what this means is that that becomes my first superpower. I really want this superpower. It means that my arms are like wires, my hands are like alligator clips. When I touch my phone, my computer, my door, my car, I'm authenticated in. First superpower. Like, I want that.
Now we have the head of PayPal saying that they want brain chips to replace passwords. Oh my goodness, huge conspiracy theorist here. This is PayPal's global head of developer evangelism. Jonathan LeBlanc is pushing implantable brain chips as a replacement for passwords, but he insists that such technology must be made to fit inside cultural norms before it is accepted by the general public. Oh, so obviously we can expect a huge psyop coming to get people to accept that this is culturally normal. But listen to some of the options here, he says. This is in a presentation called Kill All Passwords. LeBlanc admits that the future of authentication security is going to get creepy, and traditional passwords are going to be phased out due to their innumerable security flaws. But he's envisioning brain chips to measure thought patterns so that childhood memories could be invoked by the user to unlock their computer. So no longer having to remember who your first boyfriend was or the name of the street that you lived on, now these brain chips are just going to scan your memories to give you access to your vehicle, your computer, to file your taxes, all of these things. And LeBlanc says that realistically, the ones that are going to succeed, whether it's embeddable, ingestible, injectable, or what have you, these are the ones that are going to play into cultural norms, the ones that are going to meet the demands of the populace overall and not be creepy. So even though they seem creepy today, in the future, they will not be creepy. They'll be culturally normal. Now, this is also echoed by Google, who in 2013, it was revealed that they were working on an ingestible microchip that would turn on a user's entire body into a biological authentication system for your cell phone, cars, doors, and other devices. And they're also developing a wearable e-tattoo that can decipher a user's thoughts by detecting the unvocalized words in their throat. At what point in our society is any of that going to not become creepy?
Forget mobile phones. Your children and grandchildren may well want an implant instead.
You know, when we check out at the grocery store, we'll be swiping our own arm over the scanner, and that will be something we feel we can't live without.
It would be such a disadvantage to not have the implant that it essentially becomes not optional.
Let's imagine a little bit what the future might look like if I could take your stem cells and put them on a chip, or your stem cells and put them on a chip. It would be a personalized chip just for you.
And he provides that no one will be able to buy or to sell except the one that has the mark, either the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for the number is that of a man, and his number is 666.
Well, Big Brother will now be taught at a school near you. Across the country, schools are finding ways to track and monitor students inside and outside the classroom. The techniques range from chips embedded in school ID cards to GPS systems installed in computers tracking students' every move to actual surveillance cameras. And it's happening in Texas. These are the IDs students are required to carry that have tracking trips built right into them, so teachers know where their students are at all times. Well, schools say the measures will help make kids safer, but is it just going too far? To discuss this, I'm joined now by RT Web producer Andrew Blake, who just covered this story extensively on our website. Hi, Andrew.
Hey, Liz.
Good to have you here.
My pleasure.
So tell us more about these microchips.
Yeah, RFID, radio frequency identification chips, and they're used pretty regularly. I mean, I have one in my pocket right now, and if you have a New York State
you
license.
Do?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, take a look.
I mean, I don't really want to take out my driver's license and hold it in front of the camera.
All right, that's understandable.
But we do have one in there, and I use it because I was born in New York State. I used to cross into the Canadian border all the time. I have an RFID chip in mine just so that when I cross over, they know who I am, and they can go and they can scan it, and they can instantly pull up my file. You know, think of like a QR code that you see out on the street somewhere. And same concept in schools. You want to be able to chronicle as much data as you can about someone to justify some sort of good. At least, you know, that's what they're doing it for. In the case of Texas, we have a school district there where two schools so far this year have forced the students to wear these badges that have the cards inside of them, and they're using it as means of tracking the students so that they can try to cut down on the rampant truancy that's happening right there. Because in a lot of school districts, if you're not having kids showing up, the states aren't going to pay for the schools. The states are going to stop funding them. And this, I believe it's Northside District in Texas, includes San Antonio, I believe. They believe that these two schools right there, they're leaving, losing upwards of $175,000 a day in funding because students just aren't showing up to the class and the teachers can't keep track of them. So they figured, okay, well, if we know where the students are at all times, you know, they're going to be held accountable. We'll know if they're in the class. We'll make sure we will have as accurate numbers as we possibly can. We'll be able to get that funding. We'll be able to know where everyone is. And it's great if, you know, you want to make sure that you're sending your child to a school where you're going to get the best education that the state's going to be able to afford. But at the same time, yes, instantly we're seeing all these privacy concerns just start mounting up. And they're being addressed in Texas, but unfortunately not necessarily in the best way. We have a case just recently where one student, she rejected this idea. She said, I'll carry a badge on me. You can, you know, have my name, you can have my photo, but I don't want to be tracked around the school because you can, from anywhere up to like 100 feet away, they can just buzz you in on a radio and they can find out like within a couple of inches where you are in the building. And it's just, you know, it kind of just gives people the heebie-jeebies.
Understand. So students do not have a choice. This is a mandate.
We're seeing that students and parents are starting to revolt slowly but surely, but so far the school district isn't really that concerned about their complaints. We have one case of a girl who said that it would violate her religious beliefs to be tracked consistently throughout the day. It would also obviously...
Religious beliefs?
Yes.
I understand privacy concerns and religious concerns.
The mark of the beast, to have this, you know, unknowing eye on her at all times. She said, you know, my religion doesn't stand for it and I don't want to have it. And the school said, okay, this is what we're going to do. You can go ahead and you can have your regular old ID badge. But we're going to start implementing this all the way through, and there are going to be repercussions. And some students are already seeing that. If they don't have their RFID chips, they're being told that they can't check out library books. They can't pay for their lunches in the cafeteria. They can't go into certain classrooms. And we have one case in Texas where someone was told that they couldn't vote for homecoming king and queen because they didn't have their card on them. So I don't want to say that it's, oh, now they're, you know, taking away the right to vote because this is just a high school, obviously.
Right.
But it is a slippery slope,
those
obviously.
Those things like that are important, right?
Maybe to you. I don't know.
Not really.
<Yeah. laughs> we're seeing a lot of problems here. And yes, in Texas, they think that every year, because if they can adjust this truancy problem and this lack of substantial attendance figures, they can pull in maybe like $2 million a year in state funding. But meanwhile, they got 6,000 students, and they know where they are at all times, all the time, and it's kind of freaking people out. And there's a lot of concerns, not just about, like, well, I just don't want to be tracked. It kind of has, as you would imagine, like a chilling effect on how people are going to associate with one another. Like, for example, let's say I know you're a good kid in school, right? Let's say you hung out with a couple of hoodlums, though, some undesirables, right? Now, if you're hanging out in a hallway with a couple of kids who are up to no good, but you obviously are, you know, keeping to yourself, being nice and polite and stuff like that, the school's still going to know, oh, that Liz Wall, she's hanging out with those bad kids.
So she must be up to no good
also. She must be up to no good, yeah. And so people are going to pick where they hang out with. They're going to pick which extracurricular activities they participate in, because maybe some people don't want every authority figure in the school to know that they are involved in, like, let's say, like a gay and lesbian rights group like I was in high school, or like I went to the poetry circle. Maybe I didn't want a lot of people knowing I went to the poetry circle. I guess it's too late because I just said it on international television. But
I think that you should have been proud of that.
Thank you. I appreciate it. But a lot of people, though, have their concerns. They don't want everyone to know where they are, and they're worried that it's going to come back down on them and they're going to be ridiculed. And we're already seeing they're being disqualified from participating in school-wide votes. They're being disqualified from picking up their lunches and being told that, no, you come back when you can prove who you are with a computer chip. And it has a lot of people uncomfortable.
All right. Right now, so as far as I know, this is only in Texas, right?
There's a couple of cases of it happening in Texas. There are actually a few companies who market these devices for schools and other institutes all over the world, but the case that we're seeing right now is in this one school board in Texas, and it's being tried out in two schools, one elementary school, one high school, impacting roughly around 6,000 people, but right now it is just a pilot program.
And right, is this just the guinea pig? In other words, could we foresee this happening
if this
across
takes
the
off,
country and other school systems?
If this takes off, they're expecting within like a couple of years to have it advance in Texas and impact around 100,000 students in 122 different schools. And of course, like I said, you know, it's going to be a slippery slope. If we see it
slippery
working
slope.
Here,
you
it's going to work somewhere else.
ID card. Well, what happens next?
It's a very good question.
You got a chip in your somewhere else.
There's actually, I saw someone saying online that it just prepares students for the real world, where they go
the real
they enter
world.
Adulthood and they are constantly
it's
monitored.
It's not the real world I went to school in.
Yeah,
but anyways,
times are changing, Liz.
Times are changing. That much is true.
One Texas teen has been told she won't be allowed to return to her school beginning on Monday. High school sophomore Andrea Hernandez was not found to be cheating on a test or ditching class. She's not flunking out, nor did she get in a fight with fellow classmates. Andrea Hernandez has been told she can't return to school because she refuses to wear a student ID card that's implanted with a GPS identification chip. She says it's against her religious beliefs. Well, a Bexar County District Court judge has just stepped in, granting Hernandez a temporary restraining order as she awaits trial. But this is a case with some major implications. So we wanted to speak with her attorney, John Whitehead. He is a constitutional attorney. John, thanks for being on the show. This is a project at John Jay High School Science and Engineering Academy called the Student Locator Project. What's the point of all this?
Well, the point of the project supposedly is to raise money for the school. If they can put this program into effect, supposedly, and prove that they can increase attendance, they're supposed to make more money. But they've already spent $500,000 buying the chips from a large corporate entity. So money is obviously being made here. But Andrea had a religious objection to the having to wear the chip and a privacy concern. I mean, even when she went in the bathroom, she had to have a chip on. Plus, she's not being treated equally. If she doesn't have the chip, she cannot access the library, cafeteria. She was told she couldn't vote the homecoming king or queen. So she also wanted to hand out a pamphlet in the hallway saying that giving her objections to why she didn't want to wear this chip, and they were told she was told she couldn't do that.
Well, from what I understand, though, the principal offered to actually have the chip taken out of the card. Why then does she still refuse to wear it?
Well, her father and her talk, they called me and they said, well, this is if she's still wearing the so-called smart ID or student locator badge, what she's saying is, I endorse the program. And they feel so strongly about it that they said she cannot and will not endorse the program. So we filed for a temporary restraining order on the constitutional issues, and we just got a judge who says that they were going to expel her from school and put her in another school, and the judge says they can't do that. Because of the constitutional issues involved. So she's going to be back in school, and there's going to be a hearing next week.
But this is so much bigger, John, than just one case. Talk a little bit about the legal precedent here. As you mentioned, you know, the school already has surveillance cameras. Many schools have metal detectors. What's the bigger picture here?
The bigger picture here, this is the test project, which is going to spread throughout the country. And the question is going to be, if those who do not opt into this program, will they be punished? As Andrea. Andrea is a very good student, by the way. Like you said, she didn't cheat. She doesn't cheat. She does very well. This is a school that she worked her way to get into, and she's being punished because she will not go along with what she feels to be constitutional violation. So the key to the case here is whether or not those people who want privacy, they don't want to be in such a program, they have First Amendment objections, whatever, will they be punished? So I think that's why this case is a very, very much precedent case. But here's the key, I think, to all of this. What's happening, and this is the, I would call the cultural thing we're seeing, we're conditioning kids to live in the surveillance state. They're growing up in school, so when they go out into regular life, are we going to be required to wear chips as adults? I think it's kind of, that's the next step, obviously, because, again, there's money to be made off this, and police and the government agencies will track it for whatever reason.
Yeah, and this, as you mentioned, it's just a pilot program, so we don't see this happening in schools across the country. But here, school officials want to see this implemented at more than 100 schools, so more than 100,000 students, and they say they want to increase attendance. Yeah, and they say that this is supposed to help them increase attendance by tracking these students' whereabouts, and therefore, in the end, they'll get much more money from the state government. I guess, Joan, talk a little bit about the system that's in place and what concerns you about the way it's set up.
Well, the way it's set up is it grieves the bottom line, the right to privacy, First Amendment concerns, all the things that make us human beings. I mean, some people have asked me, what would you compare this to? Well, it's like a chicken in a cage. I mean, if they can track you wherever you go, the government in the school, and eventually when we grow up, kids grow up, go out in society. I mean, there's surveillance cameras everywhere now anyway. And so the question is, as human beings, will we have any privacy in the future? Orwell, as we know, in 1984, he predicted there will be no privacy. But can we have privacy? Sure. There are going to be people who are going to want to opt out. And that's the importance of this case is we want to protect those people who don't want to be part of a system they feel violates their human dignity and their constitutional rights.
Yeah, I think this is certainly just the beginning of what we'll probably see will be many more cases like this. I know your client, Hernandez, has said that this is the implementation of the mark of the beast. Do you know what she meant by that?
Yeah, in the book of Revelation, the New Testament, there's this prophecy about the Antichrist, that there will be a number put on people, and they wouldn't be able to buy and sell. So that's their belief. But incredibly, in this case, though, that's come true. If you don't have the chip, you can't go to the cafeteria, the library, you can't vote, you don't have access to certain things. So I don't agree with that particular belief. But again, the Constitution provides for the freedom of religion.
And when is this trial set to take place, John?
This coming Wednesday.
All right. Well, you keep us posted. Thanks so much for being on the show. Constitutional attorney John Whitehead.
Thank you.
Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, Write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them.
We are back on the InfoWars Nightly News, and we're going to deal now with an issue that is so important for the future of humanity. It is so central to the reason this country was founded, the basic ideas of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, of religious freedom, of being an individual in an age when we've been conditioned to accept technology creeping up on us. We're always wowed and amazed and wooed by the new cool things technology can do, and we're always just trained to ignore the fact that it's converging on a point of tracking us in a total control grid. Every piece of technology is leading up to this. It's integrating. This kind of technology started with the adoption of social security numbers and other IDs, but it is now at the point of total high tech. It's being pushed on school kids, other vulnerable groups, people who haven't reached the age of consent, who don't yet have the wisdom to say no to this. But one family is saying no. We need so many more families to join them in that fight. We are joined now by the Hernandez family. They're in San Antonio saying no to the school that wants them to mandatorily wear an ID badge with an RFID tracker inside of it. Thanks for joining us, Steve the father, Andrea at school there, and John Jay, and of course your son as well. Thanks for coming in.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I appreciate it.
So tell us about the specific program that's being introduced and some of the major issues going on in San Antonio, which, by the way, is being rolled out all across Texas and all across the nation. Right now, it's kind of in tester beta programs, but they want to expand it. So.
Oh, absolutely. This program is
being implemented at John Jay High School and Anson Jones Middle School, the only two schools with the lowest attendance rate in the city. They're putting RFID tracking chips in their kids' badges. They want to make it mandatory, and they want to make the rest of the school district pick it up. And there's 112 schools in that school district.
So they're starting with two, but it's going to 112 schools.
Absolutely, yes, sir.
Just in San Antonio.
Just in San Antonio, just in the NISD school district. They're making it mandatory that the kids have to wear it. If not, they cannot participate in certain programs at school. They cannot get their lunch or check out library books if they don't wear these badges. And we stood up and said, no, absolutely not, because we felt like it stepped on our religious freedom.
Right.
And when we got back into town, we got this letter from the NISD board saying that on August 10th, that this is when this letter was dated, that the kids would start wearing these badges. And they sent it out really close to the day that the kids had to go get their badges and register for school, because they didn't want any arguments. They didn't want anybody to resist it. But unfortunately for them, I resisted. And I went on my local news station. I said, no, my daughter will not wear this badge. They had already done a story and said, hey, we want to talk to you more about it. And now we are here today with you on your show to speak more about this.
And we do have a clip from that news piece. So let's go to that right now, and then we'll come back and enlarge the discussion.
Starting tomorrow, about 4,000 students at John Jay High School and Anson Jones Middle School must wear a new and controversial photo ID called the Radio Frequency Identification System. It tracks students while they're on campus. Some call it a spy chip. Andrea says many students just won't wear it.
I know that there's kids who will, hey man, can you hold this? I'm going to go across the street to go get tacos.
She said others might stick it in a locker to avoid monitoring.
That NISD is a school district, they're not a government.
And so there is that. There's, of course, more up on the websites. But Steve, Andrea, what's been the reaction to that news piece? And what are people saying about the fact that you don't want to go along with the system?
A lot of people are just like, oh, you're just whining. Oh, you're just complaining. You just want to fit the attention. I was like, no, this is wrong. Northside does not have the right to do this to us. And they're just like, oh, just wear the badge. You know, it's just a badge. I was like, no, this is a lot bigger than just a badge. And it's a lot more than that as well.
It really is. And Steve?
I had a guy at work actually tell me I was just exploiting this for my own benefit. I don't see how that could be, because I'm not getting paid for this. What am I exploiting? What I'm trying to exploit here is the injustice of this school district. This school district sits here and believes that they can mandate to parents and students and teachers what they can and cannot do. I've been watching it for the last 7-8 years that I've been back in San Antonio, and I've had to go up against the school district several times on different issues. They literally believe what they say is gold, it's solid, and you must do it. If not, you know, you're done. You better do as asked.
They really want to usurp the rights of parents, among other things. But you've seen stories in the past few years, it's been leading up, different school districts across the country where they want you to thumbprint for a lunch, where you have to show some kind of ID card, you know, to get a library book or something. Back in 1999, there were students in Louisiana in one town revolting against the fact they were made to wear badges with their social security number tied to a barcode. But this trumps all of that, because this RFID code, it ties into your social security number, to your name, to your photo, and they want you to use this to buy your meals at school, to get the library books, all of it. It's all being integrated.
Yeah,
absolutely. they say these chips can't be tracked except for inside the school. And Wade Garcia, who actually implemented all of this into both those schools, has come on radio publicly and said, hey, you know, we had to wait several years to get the previous superintendent out so that we get this new guy in there. And he'll go ahead and prove it. I mean, he's admitted to it, that this has been in plan for about the last 2 years, several years. So he also states that, hey, these things never shut off. They always emit a signal. Mm-hmm. And you know, if they're always emitting a signal, that means anybody with an RFID tracker can actually pull up your information. Anybody with basic computer knowledge can actually pull this up.
Yeah, it's true. They're very easy to hack, and that means sexual predators are going to be hacking. That means lawless authorities, people abusing their power, are going to be hacking the systems, probably with a ready-to-go index of students and teachers and everyone else. It's total inventory control, open season for people who are predators, wolves inside a system of people who are still sheep, people who aren't grown up yet. It would be bad enough to do it to adults.
Absolutely. And what they don't seem to understand, they're stepping on civil liberties, religious freedom, and these children who aren't old enough to make decisions for their own, they're being conditioned and told you have to do it this way. So what they're doing is taking the voices away from the children, away from the parents, away from even teachers. I know some teachers are afraid to stand up because they don't want to lose their jobs.
Yeah.
They're taking away the voice of the people. But guess what? I'm here for the voice of the people. And even for those who disagree with me, I'm fighting for you, your children, your families, not just for my two children and my family. I'm fighting for every person out there. I've been misquoted several times saying that I said this is the mark of the beast and all this fun stuff. I didn't say it was the mark of the beast. I said this is how they condition the people. Okay, but there is a correlation there.
Oh, yeah.
Because in the Bible, it says you can't buy, sell, you can't participate pretty much in the economy if you don't have the mark of the beast. But guess what? In that school, they're being told, hey, you can't buy your lunch unless you have this badge. You can't get your library books unless you have this badge. Sounds very similar to me.
It was extremely prescient, and people like to discount Bible prophecy, but it's so strongly worded. Everyone knows about that passage. You can read it if you want. How did they know that was coming? Doesn't matter if it's just dictators, if it's just men on earth and not devils running things. They've still gone with the same plan.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, if the Bible wasn't true, I wouldn't be sitting here today with you. That's just plain and simple. If it wasn't in there, it wasn't written. I was 5 years old when my parents started teaching me the Bible and taking me to church. Now imagine, if you will, 11 o'clock at night, you're 5 years old, you can barely keep your eyes open. Your dad has you down on the carpet talking and reading you the Bible. And he starts talking about the mark of the beast, talking to you about these little chips they want to pin in you the size of a grain of rice. You don't know what to think. You're a child. But here I am, 42 years old, 37 years later, all of a sudden I'm finding myself in the middle of it. Now, I'm in the middle of it and I got to take care of my children. It is my responsibility as a parent to take care of my family, my wife, my son, my daughter. I have to stand up and protect them. And this is exactly what I'm doing today. I'm standing up to protect my wife and my children. And I'm not going to allow this to happen. We are not going to compromise our faith for NISD. We're not going to compromise for the government. We're just not going to do it.
Well, why will they make certain provisions for religious reasons for extreme minorities? And those people should have the right to their religious freedom. It's, you know, part of the tradition of this country, and it makes sense anyway. But why will they run wholesale over huge blocks of Christians and just completely ignore a very well-known provision? I mean, that is a line in the sand for so many people. The RFID chip, the mark of the beast, whatever you see it as, maybe some future technology still coming, but it's all headed in the same direction of control and really disrespect for human individuals.
Yeah, there is a disrespect, and the reason they run over the Christians because they know if they can squash the Christians and they can squash God's word, they can take over the world and do what they want to do. But unfortunately for them, the book has already been written.
Yeah.
God wins, okay? The Christian people win. So they can try as they might, but it's not going to it's just not going to work out for them. You know, I would rather be on the side of the Lord and reap my rewards in heaven than reap my rewards here on earth. There's more to this. And I've had the opportunity to witness to people and talk to people the last several weeks, get people saved. I believe that God has chosen us to help to fight this. Mm-hmm. I mean, who would ever think? I went on television, my local news station, said, no, we're not going to do this. And here I am today, two, three protests later, visits with the NISD, I have all kinds of organizations and people from around the world gathering behind us. Who would think one man stood up and made that big of a difference? And then, why did I stand up? Because my daughter told me, Dad, I'm not going to wear it. I am not going to wear it. And she's right. She doesn't have to. I mean, she can tell you things that has been going on in the school that the teachers have been telling the students about wearing the badge. It's absolutely absurd.
And you were talking earlier, Andre, about how you're not a product. You've got an image on one of your binders at school about, I am not a product. But this is exactly what they're trying to do, is treat us as human cattle, as we're part of an inventory system. The way they're tracking boxes that come from Walmart and go to stores across the country and everything.
Yeah.
But we're human beings.
Exactly. And that's what Northside seems to forget. They think that we're just money. We're just cattle. They don't think of us as a person. They just think that, oh, they're just more money for our pocket. They're just more money for the budget. But they don't realize that, you know, yes, they have a budget, and yes, they have money, but it's
supposed to be for the students. It's supposed to be for the fine arts, for the athletics, for the teachers, not for their own personal gain.
Yeah, but they always seem to have funding for these high technology control systems. Yeah. But, you know, then they have to cut the arts, they have to cut the sports programs. And
absolutely. You know, Northside just, oh, we don't have any money to do anything, we don't have any money for our teachers, so let's let go all of our teachers, but let's bring in these new chips. That kind of, you know, we're not supposed to have any money, but yet we have enough money for this tracking program. And then this is just the beginning, you know, there's 110 more schools that have to get this chip as well if we don't stop it here and now.
Yeah, and I want to talk specifically about fighting back because it does make a big difference. On the RFID front, they've already moved to chip most pets in many cities, try to put forward the idea that's somehow mandatory. People have, on the other hand, fought back against that because the microchips have been found to cause cancer in pets and animals, and nobody wants to see that. But the fact that people have protested against that issue has really hurt the main companies putting out the RFID technology. So they can suffer from us speaking back. It's a consumer issue, but it's also a rights issue. And parental rights, your rights as a member of a public school, that all factors into that. So let's talk about how we could fight back and how do we get other people out there with you helping on this issue?
Well, what we've been trying to do, we actually go out and we talk with people and let people know. But, you know, people can go to spychips.com and read about it. Mm-hmm. All of our protests, all the pictures that we have up there are, you know, they're going there. We have videos. We actually have a video that was released of everybody talking to the NISD board of trustees. Mm-hmm. Karen Freeman from NISD said that, hey, you know, we can listen to you, but it doesn't mean we have to act on it. So that tells me, hey, she wants to stand her ground. But guess what? You know, we have a group of 20 million strong behind us and all kinds of different organizations throughout the world, people from all over the place. Like Catherine Albrecht told me, you put a little bit of fire underneath them, they're going to stop. She goes, so let's light this fire. Okay. I have to give my hats off, my thanks to Catherine Albrecht, Katie Deloitte.
Yeah, she's done a lot of very good work on this, and she has put pressure on specific companies. She's followed them, and she could do the same for these public institutions.
Absolutely. Liz McIntyre, all of them, they have single-handedly put them back by at least 10 years by all these protests that they've been doing throughout the United States and England and all over the world. You know, and I'm proud to be part of that. And, you know, these people need to understand, you cannot mandate to a free society what people have to do. You cannot just say, hey, you're going to wear it and you're going to like it. You can't. We are the United States of America. We are a free nation. We're supposed to be a free nation. We are not United States of Northside Independent School District. They are not a government. And even if they were a government, they cannot tell us we have to wear chips, that they can track us anytime they like. It's enough that they're tracking us with our credit cards, our cell phones, our phone bills. There's some things you can't get around, but this I can get around. This I would say no to. My daughter's not going to wear this badge. This badge was okay, even though it has barcodes on it and has a little scanny thing of a bob on the back, but this one is no good. I don't like it. It has two batteries and it has a chip right here. It never turns off. And with that being said, she will never wear it. My son will not wear it when and if it comes to his school.
I mean, we're talking about the privacy concerns, which are the big things, but there's also the environmental pollution. Are these devices safe to even wear next to the heart in different parts of the body? There's been a lot of stuff brought out on different Wi-Fi signals, and this is becoming a problem.
Yeah, it emits a radiation cloud around the body.
Yeah.
Up to 70 feet in diameter, I believe they were saying. So anybody can drive by with an RFID scanner and get your information. Okay. Northside Independent School District likes to say, hey, you know, in their paperwork here, it says, you know, you can't scan it outside the school district, outside the school, the four walls of the school. It's not true.
Except they're telling every student to go home with it and show up with it first thing in the morning.
Yeah, absolutely. And we walk home. A lot of us, a lot of my friends, they live right down the street from the school. They walk home. I walk home, and I walk pretty far home. And the fact that somebody could pick up my signal while I'll be waiting for the cars to pass scares me, and that is extremely frightening.
It really should. But what kind of message are they sending to the students in the first place that you must accept this? Trying to tell parents with that same hoax they use on the vaccine issue that this is not a negotiable issue. Somehow, just because it's a state government authority, we could just tell you what you're going to do. Now, I mean, what kind of kids are we training for the future?
They're trying to condition the kids. They're trying. That's how all of these governmental bodies start. They start with the kids. Let's start with the kids. We condition the children to think it's okay and it's normal to be tracked.
I don't mean to be inflammatory. Hitler said that. He said, get the children, get the women, then you get the whole society.
Exactly. And he knew what he was doing. That's why he did what he did.
Yeah.
You know, you always start with the children. Why? Because they know that's the most sensitive part of a parent's heart. You grab that kid, and that parent's going to go along with it. You grab that spouse, that other one's going to go along with it. But guess what? In Hernandez family, that's not going to happen. My family would much rather be persecuted, and if we have to die for our cause, but guess what? It's not our cause. It's we're dying for our Lord Jesus Christ, God Almighty. I would rather reap my rewards in heaven than reap them here on earth.
And we're supposed to fight back against tyranny. It's in the Bible. You're not supposed to lay around waiting for the apocalypse to happen. You're supposed to be doing what's right and standing up for what's right.
Well, absolutely. You know, if you don't stand for something, then what are you really doing? You're just existing and going through life?
Yeah, doing what
you're
told.
You got to stand for something.
Yeah.
Got to stand for something. And I keep telling everybody, I can't believe I'm here in this situation at this part in my life. I stood up 2 weeks ago and said no. My daughter said no.
Yeah.
You know, in her school, they're actually bribing the children with candies and gifts to wear it around their necks.
Mm-hmm. I have a classmate in my third period. The teacher, she was standing outside the door with a big old bucket of candy, and the kids that had already had their IDs on, she gave them candy, and I was like, where'd you guys get the candy? How come I didn't get one? They go, oh, she's giving them out if you have your ID. And I was like, what? They go, yeah. She said if we wear them around our neck, we get the candy. And I was like, are you serious? And then, you know, they're like, oh, you're going to get in trouble. You'll lose your position on your extracurricular activities like football and cheer and pep and stuff like that. Those coaches are saying that you must wear them and they must be visible at all times. And, you know, it's making it hard even to go to the restroom now because you have to have it on in the hallways. That way we know who you are. If you want to know who I am, get to know me. Sit down with me and talk with me. Don't put a badge on me.
Yeah, I mean, what happened to a name and a face and getting to know people? But the other thing, too, they're trying to control you through peer pressure at a time when you're growing up, you're trying to figure out who you are, you're trying to meet other people, make friends, and that's what's going to get noticed, the fact you're an individual, that you're strong enough to stand up for yourself. You're the kind of person people want to get to know and respect in the community. People who just go along with whatever they're told to do, well, that's pretty uninteresting, really.
Yeah, and you know, I get a lot of people who are supposed to be friends or supposed to be people that are on my side at all times, and then yet when this issue gets brought up, oh, I don't talk to you, or, you know, just weird, dude, it's not a big deal. But the thing is, it's a really big deal, and, you know, students need to understand that. They need to open their eyes, because Northside is just saying, oh, it's not dangerous, it's not, you know, it's not a big deal. And yet, they track you at school, and they tell you, oh, I don't track you on the bus, but they do. I asked my bus driver, and I said, sir, what is this little thing above your window? He goes, oh, that's for the home project. And I was like, what home project? And he's like, oh, your badges? And I was like, the new ones? He goes, yep. That's what it's for. So now they track me on my bus ride home, and, you know,
I'm sorry, you have to scan this when you get on the school bus?
No, it picks up the signal just like it does at the school. It picks up the signal and lets you know who's on the bus.
Wow. I mean, really dangerous. All sold in the name of safety, but it's completely hijackable and exploitable by the wrong person in authority. Just like everything.
Absolutely. You know, I'd like to know how this makes anybody any safer.
This is a centralized system. Our government was set up on a balance of powers, knowing that bad people are going to get into power, and it's better for them to fight amongst each other than to give all the power to one person.
And this is exactly what they've done, sir. They have given all the power to the school district and a handful of police officers who can watch this at all times. Okay? They have people thinking, hey, in case of a fire, this would be great. I don't understand. How is it going to be great? Because growing up, and even to this day, everybody has fire drills at school anyways, right? So we all know how to get out of the school.
Yeah.
What about the poor guy who's sitting in there trying to find the last person with a badge? Let's say, for instance, that kid decided, well, I'm going to put my badge over here in the bathroom.
Because it's time to get out of here. Yeah. I don't have time to grab
exactly.
That badge.
Exactly. So they're doing this for money, and they're doing this for power. It costs $525,000 to implement this program in only two schools. In only two schools. Costs $136,000 a year to run that program. Now take those numbers and multiply it by the other 110 schools. And then take that number of 136,000 and multiply that by those schools. It's astronomical. Where are they coming up with the money? And what people don't understand, it's our tax dollars that are going to this program.
But they want to fire teachers.
But they want to get rid of teachers. They don't have chairs for psych classes. They don't have books. There's some teachers printing books for students off their printers because they don't have money for books. But yet they have $525,000 to implement a program that nobody wants?
It's really creepy. So what do you think is the best way to get other parents to recognize the danger, other students to realize this isn't such a good idea? How do we start to say no to this, to have the courage to stand up and realize the school is not the ultimate authority? I mean, you've made a big stand already, but have you seen other people supporting you, or are they all just skeptical of what you're doing?
There's a few that support me. I heard about one kid who actually zapped his badge, put it in the microwave, and boop, zapped it, you know, so I was like, okay, you know, at least, you know, somebody agrees with me. But I have a bunch of kids who are just like, you know, whatever. And I was like, no, it's not whatever. It's invasion of your privacy. And a lot of people are like, well, I'm a Christian. And a kid actually told me the other day, he goes, well, why are you doing this? And I was like, because, you know, you're stepping on my religious beliefs. He goes, well, what religion are you? And I was like, well, you know, I'm a Christian. He goes, well, I'm sort of a Christian. And the first thing that pops in my head is like, how can you be sort of a Christian? You either are or you aren't. It's simple as that. And I was like, well, look, you know, this is, you know, the implementing of the Mark of the Beast. And he goes, this is a badge, just wear it. And I looked at him and I was like, okay, if you want to wear your badge, that's fine. But as for me, I will not wear my badge. And I turned around and left him alone.
Well, you understand the larger picture of what's going on. I mean, you're in the engineering department, you're studying for that kind of studies. You obviously know what's in the Bible, know what your religion is. These people guaranteed can't read their literature books they're assigned, aren't reading the Bible, have no idea what's in these verses. And it's very sad, but we've got to help wake people up and nudge them back to the fact that information is how you empower yourself.
Yeah.
Information is knowledge. Okay. Yeah. A lot of these people are scared. They don't want to stand up for themselves. They're afraid, oh, if I don't do this or tell my child not to do this, we're going to be in so much trouble. But all they got to do is look at us. We're not in trouble. Okay? So for those who are misinformed, we have to find a way to inform them. And how do we do that? We, by these position papers that we presented to the board or trustees. This position paper states why these things should not be used and if you're going to use them, what you need to do. Okay? We've been handing out flyers, position papers. We've been talking to people. We've got websites coming up. The kids have a Facebook that they put up, Gabby and my daughter, Andrea. Gabby is another student from Marshall High School who stood up with her mom, who was used to teach in NISD for 7 years. Mm-hmm. And she stood up and she says, I used to be a teacher, a substitute teacher as well, and I disagree with this. And her daughter stood up and said, hey, my name is Gabby. I'm not number whatever her number is, okay?
Exactly.
So how do we get people informed? By doing what we're doing today. We come on shows like this, we go on the internet, we go on radio talk shows, we hand out information, we just talk to people. You know, we're getting to the point where we're getting ready to start knocking on doors in our community. But, you know, we're inviting everybody to go to NISD website, contact Brian T. Woods and the Board of Trustees, and tell them what your objection is. We object to this. We don't want it. We go to WOAI Channel 4, their poll shows that 71% of people believe this is an invasion of privacy.
Yeah.
But those 71% of the people need to get up and say, hey, Mr. Brian T. Woods, we don't want this. We're done with it. I am not afraid to stand up for my civil liberties, my religious freedom, and the protection of my children.
And we better not be, because they're going to keep going and keep going and keep going. Now, specifically, we ought to contact the people locally at your schools in San Antonio, because that's where they're trying to roll it out and get a stronghold. But people all across the nation, this is a national and global show, they need to preemptively contact their school districts and tell them not to even consider this, because it's dangerous, it's costly, as you pointed out, and it's really a destructive force against our privacy and our individual rights. And that's the bottom line.
That's the bottom line. It's an invasion of privacy. But my first and foremost fight is religious belief. It's my religious freedom, my kids' religious freedom. I'm not going to condemn my children to the pit because NISD wants them to wear a chip. My daughter stood up and she told them at the board, she told the board, and she says, I'm not going to compromise my freedom for NISD. And it's online right now. You can watch it. It should be on spychips.com. Mm. And it's there. And let me tell you what, we're going to fight this. This is not just the end. This is the beginning. We're going to put an end to this. no matter what. But our goal as a family and as a community and everybody who does support us, we are putting out information. You see a bunch of papers here in front of you because we're bringing information to you, and it's the same information we're giving out to the people. I mean, we have great support. We have almost 15 different organizations around the world. And you know, from Caspian to We Are Change San Antonio, We Are Change Texas Hill Country. I mean, we have Matthew Medina, we have Catherine Albrecht, Liz McIntyre, all these people, Katie DeOise. Katie came to my house and spent the weekend with us to help us put this protest together. She took time out of her schedule and her children and her family to come to be with us. I mean, I am grateful, and I have to tell everybody, and I just, this is my opportunity to give thanks to a good friend of mine named Bobby Scott. If it wasn't for Bobby Scott, I wouldn't be here today. Because I was at work, my phone was ringing, I couldn't get to it, and I'm not supposed to have my phone at work. And at break time, I went to check, he'd call me 6 times. So I decided to call him, and I said, what's going on? He said, hey, dude, I called you a couple hours ago because you need a guy on the radio right now. They're talking about you. And I'm asking him, you know, what are they talking about? Because they're talking about you and these chips. You need to contact this lady named Katie somebody. And so I went on that particular radio station's website, contacted Katie DeLoyes. The very next day, I got a phone call, and here I am 2 weeks later right here in Austin, Texas, with you folks. And we have to tell you thank you. You guys are wonderful.
We appreciate y'all standing up and coming out and speaking out, because everyone's against the issue who knows about these larger political issues. How could you not be? But to have a focal point of, you know, someone inside the school system standing up, it's so powerful, because that's where the pressure really falls on them. And these companies who put out the RFID, they can be financially hurt. They could be bankrupted. It's happened. Oh, there'll be private funders and people giving them endless grants later, but still, we could back them off and eventually defeat the system, and this is a great way to start. Did you want to give out that Facebook, because you mentioned that?
Yeah.
Where you're trying to rally people.
Go ahead, honey.
Our Facebook page, the one that me and Gabby created, is called Students Against RFID Tracking, and that is our Facebook page, and you can go and like, and we have videos and pictures and links to spy chips and all these other organizations and stuff that people need to see so they can be more informed.
Great. We hope people check that out. And are y'all doing on the street protests or anything like that?
Yeah, we had done one in front of Anson Jones the first day of school. We did it again, did it twice. Then we did one about a week ago at NISD, the Northside Independent School District, district office, the superintendent's office. Then we went inside, and it was Citizens to Be Heard. And there was about 6 or 7 of us that stood up and voiced our concerns. We had teachers, we had people from different organizations. And I stood up, my daughter stood up, and Gabby. So a lot of things came out of that, but we were planning to hold another one. I believe it's going to be on the 25th. I think it's every second Tuesday of the month they have a Citizens to Be Heard. So we're hoping to get hundreds of people to show up out there in support of this. And a lot of things have come out of this, and I've had a couple of people approach me to see if I wanted to run for office after this. So, you know, I was asked if I wanted to run for mayor or city council. And that's something that I would love to do. But right now, in order to get that part, I need to kick this in the
pants. Win this battle.
And I guarantee you, and I promise you right here, we're going to win this battle, because of folks like you who are standing behind us saying, hey, help, let us help you put your word out. That's what we're here for. You know, and folks like you are helping us. I think it's going to really just make this thing just so much more explosive.
Well, I mean, we're human beings. We don't need no stinking badges.
That's right. We don't need no stinking badges. Yes, sir.
I just want to read this quote real quick, and then we'll close out. I'll get your response to it. This from Carol Quigley, 1966. Do you have the quote in there, guys? I just want to read this, because this system has been coming for a long time. And Carol Quigley writes on page 866, in general, freedom and choice will be controlled within very narrow alternatives by the fact that he will be numbered from birth and followed as a number through his educational training, his required military and other public service, his tax contributions, his health and medical requirements, his final retirement and death benefits. This is a government system. This is a control grid interlinked with the big corporations who see us as inventory. They don't see us as human beings. And they have plans to literally control us from cradle to grave. And RFID tracking technology plays a huge role in that. It's so scary, all the more because they've been planning it for so long. What's your reaction to that, Steve and Andrew?
Well, you know, the fact that they said in the quote that all throughout the education. They're only starting in middle school and high school because they haven't been able to, you know, do anything else to the elementary kids. I mean, they're little kids, you know, what are they going to do? Are they going to go skip school? No, you know, they're little, they're going to go do their education.
Right.
You know, and in high school and middle school, I understand there's a little bit more of a rebellion kind of thing. But for the most part, majority, they do go to school, they do learn, and they do take their tests and their quizzes and all that stuff. And in fact, they do want to put it in the elementaries where it's unnecessary. It's unnecessary in all the schools, but they want to put it in, and it's, you know, ridiculous to a point where I wish I could talk to you for hours and hours and hours and tell people that, you know, there's so much more to this than just a badge. It's not just a chip or anything. It's a lot bigger, you know. People can find you with this stuff, and you don't even need to know anything about the person. If there's a sexual predator out there, they can find you just because it emits a signal, you know, mm-hmm. because they have no boundaries, they have no respect, and they have nothing. So they don't mind going spending $200 off of eBay of all the places to go get an RFID scanner that can pick you up, you know, when you walk home from school like me and a bunch of friends do. Boop, there you go, I got her. You know, she'll walk home alone tomorrow and I can follow her home.
And so creepy, and who's going to protect against that?
Yeah, and it's all alone, you know, I'm at the point in time where I'm coming home and everybody's at work or they're barely coming home and all the kids are already home because I get home later than everybody else. And, you know, I walk all by myself, all on this real big street. Nobody out there to protect me but myself.
And that quote in that book is absolutely correct. They, at birth, what do we get? A social security number.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. When you go into school, you get an ID badge. And on this ID badge is your student ID. Okay. You get in a checking account, you have a number assigned to you. Okay. When we're born, we have a name assigned to us. Now it's looking like we don't need names no more. We just need numbers. Okay. When you die, your name goes with you to the grave, but your number is still out there because they know that you're dead. They say, okay, number so-and-so is mm-hmm. now gone. Yeah, it's absolutely correct. They track you from the cradle to the grave and in between, and that's the way it is. We are no longer people. We are products. But guess what? Stephen Hernandez, Andre Hernandez, Vincent Hernandez, we are not products. I tell you what, we are products. We are products of the Lord Jesus Christ, God Almighty. We are His children. And if we stand for God, He'll stand for us. Or if God stands for you, then who can stand against you? Greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. Many people don't understand what that means. What that means is God is great. If He's inside you, if He's your Lord God, your Savior, and He can protect you no matter where you go.
Mm-hmm.
He that is in the world refers to the devil or people who are worldly, who want the worldly possessions right here, right now. Guess what? Your gift is greater in heaven than it is on earth. You see Hollywood and actors and sports guys, I mean, they all live in the great life. But not one has opened the Bible to read it. Not if they have, they don't live by it. I'm not saying that we're a perfect family. We all have our faults.
Right.
But I tell you what, my fault is standing up with what is right. This, sort of okay with. This, I'm not. And my family, my children will not wear this. And I ask everybody out there watching this show today, please support us. Go to those websites, call that school district, send out emails. Whatever you got to do to help us, we would appreciate it. We're asking for help. That's why we're here today, to tell our story. We want that help. We want people to come out and support us in drones. We want hundreds of people to come out there because it would make our plight greater and make our stance known more. I'm here today to ask for everybody's help, and I want to give thanks to, once again, to my friend Bobby Scott out there. I can't thank him enough. Catherine Albrecht, Liz McIntyre, Katie, Matt Medina, Chris, Steve, every person, Alex Jones. I tell you what, you, every guy that's sitting in the studio today, you guys are all been wonderful, and God bless you all, and we're just asking for help. So if there's anybody out there, feel free to go to those websites. Feel free to come visit at NISD. And let's make our voices heard.
He is a real-life Cyberman, a scientist with an implanted computer chip. A tiny lump is all that gives it away. A wave of his digitally enhanced hand and security doors magically open. Only he can operate his phone, and only if he holds it in the hand fitted with a chip. But now Dr. Mark Gasson is suffering a very 21st century malady, the first human to be infected with a computer virus.
When the systems read my tags, the computer virus has actually appeared throughout the whole database. So it's actually replicated itself and copied it throughout the database. So any of these people that are using their swipe cards to access the building, the actual virus would be copied onto their card.
The cybernetics expert at the University of Reading had the chip implanted in a minor operation. In future, your medical records could be stored like this, but the chips are vulnerable. This is just like the chip that's implanted in Dr. Gasson's hand. It's called an RFID, a tag that's been used for many years to track goods around the world. But these days they're far more powerful and they're being used in more and more applications. They're like mini computers, and just like a computer, they're vulnerable to viruses. Already many implanted medical devices like heart pacemakers have onboard computers that communicate with doctors. If they're corrupted by a virus, the consequences for patients could be fatal. And in future, chips will be used even more widely, perhaps even as memory upgrades for the brain. They too could be scrambled by malicious computer code.
These type of devices are going to have to start to use secure encrypted communication. The medical devices really should have some sort of password protection as well. I mean, it's very basic security precautions, which surprisingly these devices don't have at the moment.
Our bodies have been fighting biological viruses for millions of years, but as man and machine merge, so computer viruses could prove a new threat to human health.
The end purpose of numbering a population is always to control them. And do I need to remind you that control and freedom are opposite terms? If Fido's on a leash, he's under control. But if the leash breaks and he runs through the neighborhood, now he's free. So what do we want to do? Do we want to be on the leash of big government, or do we want to be free? You cannot have freedom when the population is numbered.
Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666.